So here with Patrick Timms from the Wolves of Westminster blog. Welcome back. This time you're not at the House of Commons, you're at home. Patrick, what was the feeling like in the Commons last week? Just gives a bit of an update. I've been for a while myself.
Well, it was a pretty normal day. It's the only thing I can say there, really. You know, we people were recently returned and debates were going on. Select committee hearings were going on. And of course, there's one in particular that's been in the news recently.
Yeah, exactly. So let's talk about Dominic Cummings then giving evidence. It was quite, I mean, it was almost like too kind of anti-government, wasn't it? I mean, it was kind of interesting to listen to. I'm sure some of it is true. But I mean, how much damage is that going to do to the government? Are we just going to have to wait till next year when the official inquiry starts?
Well, some people have been saying, look, you know, it's as though he's preempting the inquiry. And I imagine that probably is part of the plan. It doesn't seem to have dented the government's reputation too much thus far. There were some very serious points that were made about the government's and civil services preparedness for such a pandemic. And Mr. Cummings was very scathing about the health secretary. I think anyone watching it would have discerned that pretty quickly. But thus far, there doesn't seem to have been a huge impact. Now, but with any, some, you know, some people have said he's behaving like a jilted lover. Others have said he's just lifting the lid on what was actually going on. Yeah. And as ever with these things, I imagine that the truth is probably somewhere in the middle.
Yeah. I mean, what about some of these key claims then, saying, you know, that this government strategy was herd immunity? I mean, in some ways, the government strategy is herd immunity now, because the vaccination drive is about getting jabs in arms. We're getting towards 60% of the population that are going to have their first jab, what, nearly getting on towards 80% second jab. So that is their strategy, isn't it, in a way? So it depends what you mean by herd immunity.
Well, it is, to be honest, it's a matter of public record that was the original strategy. I mean, yeah, to try and turn that into news at this point is only going to be of interest to people who weren't paying attention at the time, if we're being quite honest, because yes, it was. And then there was the paper that came out, the study that was showing, oh my God, everyone's going to die, which has since been, I think questioned is the nicest way to put it. But yes, there was a strategy around saying, look, you know, we'll ride this out. There will be herd immunity if we just all carry on. Then things changed. So this is the thing with some of the Cummings evidence. I mean, a lot of it is not necessarily what you might call new. But I think, to be fair, if we look at the way that this pandemic has affected all of us, I think, you know, people's memories have got shorter. Let's put it that way.
Care home.
For some people, yes, it will come as news.
Yeah, I think the care homes, I mean, this is going to be a major part of this inquiry, isn't it? Why people that were tested positive for COVID or suspected to have COVID were transferred from a hospital setting into a care home. That seems to me is going to be the central question for this inquiry. There's going to be lots of questions, but that will be one of the big ones, I would say, because that seems to be where, you know, that seems almost criminal if that, you know, depending on how that was done. And you know, were patients tested for COVID before they were sent into the care home? That would be a question too. And that's where Matthew Hancock, the health secretary's, come under fire.
Well, exactly. And yes, I think it's one of the decisions that was made during the pandemic that has been universally panned. And as you say, the inquiry, when it comes, we'll have to look at that, and we will have to get the facts as to why that happened. At the moment, there might be scraps of evidence around the place, but we don't know. And really, in some ways, speculation as in politics is pretty universal, but we probably shouldn't speculate until we're actually looking at the matter properly.
Yeah, exactly. Access to documents. I wonder what the terms are going to be for this inquiry, Patrick. Yeah. We've mentioned this a few times before now. That's going to be key, isn't it? And are people going to have to, as I presume, they're going to have to swear under oath when they give evidence? A bit like the phone hacking inquiry when that happened there. I mean, so it is going to be major. It's going to be, you know, mainstream TV is really, isn't it? It's going to be kind of a lot of people are going to want to be involved in that and to want to watch it. So it's going to be a big thing when that kicks off next year in 2022.
Absolutely. And to be fair, that, you know, the government, the Prime Minister has announced it will be a fully independent inquiry.
Yeah.
I think he would have been far too boxed into a corner to be able to say anything else. So that's where we are now. And we'll see when it happens. It's supposed to be beginning the spring of next year, I believe, at this point. So we will see. And of course, the other one, you might call it, the People's COVID inquiry into that, which was chaired by, I can't remember his name now, yeah. QC. Yeah, he was, Mansfield, that's him. They had their final session, I think, last night.
Right.
Yeah. Now, I wasn't present for that, but yeah, there's been 8 sessions, and it was clear, as I said before, that this was basically just an attempt to just rip into the government. You know, there was never going to be any sense of a proper inquiry, and this is a shame, really, I think, for someone like Michael Mansfield. But you know, it's not as though he hasn't been known to do it before. But they took it all very seriously, and they did things by proper procedures. I was there for a couple of the sessions. It's just that everything is incredibly biased. Now, we don't know whether that's going to be the case. I should hope it wouldn't be for the inevitable inquiry that is coming. But I think certainly some of the topics that were touched upon in the People's version will also be coming out.
Yeah. I mean, we're going to need a proper one inquiry where people have access to documents. I don't think this other inquiry would have had access to the documents. That's going to be key here, isn't it? To get access to emails, documentation. So, I mean, this is going to be the proper inquiry. I mean, what would you like to see happen in terms of, you know, carrying out the recommendations from this inquiry? I mean, do you think there's going to be resignations going to flow out of this? Because I'm thinking next election, you know, possibly, 2024 there for the next election, possibly even a year before 2023. That's going to be part of the thinking and the timing, the process of this inquiry and when it wraps up and when it presents its findings.
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's personally, I think it's highly likely that resignations are inevitable coming out of this. And there are possibly, you know, I won't say too much, but I would imagine that there are a couple of figures who sort of know this and are just waiting, knowing that they will be scapegoated by this. I say scapegoated. I think it's an inevitable realization that there were some terrible decisions made during this pandemic. But to be fair, this is the way these kind of inquiries always works. You know, somebody's head needs to roll.
Yeah.
So, and then that's what ends up happening. But actually, I think to look at this properly, there was a systemic failure within the system to have the faintest idea how to deal with anything like this. With that said, I think some people are being a bit unfair, because the reality is that unless you go all the way back to the Spanish flu and that sort of thing, you know, 100 years ago, the world was a very different place. This hasn't happened before. We've never done this before. And if people are going to seriously say, oh, we should have definitely been prepared for something that's never happened before, I mean, that's actually a contradiction in terms. So while it is true, I think, that objectively some decisions were made that were so poor that they do demand resignation and replacement, there are others that were poor, but what do you expect, you know, in a situation like this?
Unfortunately, unless you've been affected by this, which is really sad, a lot of people just seem to want to get on with their life, get the vaccination, make sure they, you know, the economy gets back up and running. So it's almost a divided country, really, though, isn't it? I mean, it is kind of a bit divided, because obviously you've got some people that kind of weren't that affected that want to carry on. People that lost loved ones, obviously they want answers, which is stands to reason. So it's kind of a mixed picture, isn't it, in terms of the electoral prospects for the government and next election, given that they've got a hefty majority, over 60 seats majority.
Well, sort of. I mean, if you look at opinion polling, it looks like most people are in the former camp and people just want to get on with it.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think, yes, you will have people who say this really should have been done differently, it should have been done better. But actually, there are as many different opinions, I think, as to how differently things should have been done as there are people espousing them. So, you know, there isn't really, I wouldn't say there was a united front there, but most people, yes, do, I think, just want to get back on with things. They understand that the government was in a very difficult situation. They're happy with hopefully what will be their freedom that returns, the full freedom later this month. And the public appears to be in a fairly forgiving mood for now, which, you know, might be a potential misstep of Mr. Cummings, that he might have imagined that saying the things that he said recently now would inflame public opinion. But if that was what he thought, then it doesn't really seem to have done so, except among the commentariat.
Yeah, exactly. All right, I'm going to leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be speaking a lot more to Patrick Timms about Westminster politics. Join us then. Back here with Patrick Timms from the Wolves of Westminster blog. Patrick, so Boris got married then, and no one really knew much about it until last weekend.
Well, that's right. And I think the Prime Minister and or his press team have played an absolute blinder there. I think much of the press was inevitably very disappointed that they didn't know about it. You did have the spectacle from before of people of Boris and Carrie sort of telling people to reserve the date next year for when they were going to get married, and then they went and did it, which is an absolute blind. I think it was an exclusive in the Telegraph in the end, a few hours after it happened. So, of course, people did find out eventually. But yes, that's definitely something that I can tell you in the corridors of Fleet Street, people are not particularly pleased with what went on there, which I'm quite happy with. We also know that Carrie has changed, definitively has changed her surname. She is now Carrie Johnson.
Yeah, exactly. And all the best for the Prime Minister as well. I mean, it kind of, I'm sure it wasn't deliberate, but it kind of put Dominic Cummings' exploits at the committee that same week off the front pages as well. So it did help for sure, didn't it? Because he didn't really, you know, his wedding was more of a story than Dominic Cummings and a lot of the right-wing press and in the Sundays.
I think we can only speculate on the extent to which that was deliberate. I'll tell you what I enjoyed most actually was the photos, because I thought both of them looked very happy. I thought the Prime Minister in particular looked very relaxed. He's lost even more weight, and he looked very happy, which, you know, hopefully after the year that he's had, and we've all got to have some sympathy with that, you know, hopefully now things are looking up. Because, you know, he came in as the Prime Minister a couple of years ago and swept in to sort of deliver Brexit. That was his job, and he did that. And then, you know, as Peter Apisa wrote for The Express a little while ago, in which what I was saying was, it wasn't supposed to be like this, you know? You know, the Brexit was supposed to happen, and then, oh, sunless uplands, et cetera.
Yeah.
What did happen a month or two later? All of this. You know, there was no breathing room at all. And then, of course, he got ill and nearly died. You know, he has a child, he has a wife now. And perhaps now, if we're able to look at opening up fully on June the 21st, as has been promised, maybe now things will get back to the way they were supposed to have been sort of 15 months ago.
Yeah, possibly. Now, we're going to be one of the strongest growing economies as well, aren't we, this year, according to the OECD. So, what, we're going to grow over 6%, I think, last time I looked.
7%, something like that, yeah.
Yeah, so that's going to be looking good. And what about opening up fully on the 21st of June? It's, a lot of people are pushing for that, but then you get some people that still want, a lot of people are saying we should lock down again. Where do you stand on this, and what are your feelings about it?
Well, thus far, the government has been continuing to insist that the data is showing that it's safe, and that there is not at present a particular reason, despite the Indian variant, there's not a particular reason to delay the roadmap. I think the government itself, not just the Prime Minister, but the Health Secretary and various others, have invested a lot of political capital in really following the roadmap this time. You know, you look at the disaster back right at the start of this year when we opened schools for one day and then closed them again. I think what people have realised in as much of a political as a scientific and healthcare sense is that we can't keep doing this. So I personally imagine at the moment that, yes, the June the 21st reopening will probably go ahead. However, it is, I suppose, possible that in the coming months after that, you know, if there is new data that the government is unlikely to shy away from saying, okay, we need to put some limited restrictions in place in local areas in particular.
Yeah.
You may well see that happening.
I mean, when do you think that we're actually going to be, all of those restrictions are going to be off the statute book? When do you think that's ever going to happen? Or are we going to keep some of this kind of face mask wearing laws on public transport, for example?
I mean, anyone who tells you they know is not telling the truth. Nobody knows. I did write a piece last year when they brought in the wearing of face masks in shops and that sort of thing as a law. And because I was actually quite opposed to that. But the piece argued that if we're going to do it, then at least do it with a law, as opposed to what Michael Gove, the Chancellor of the Duke of Lancaster, was saying at the time. He was saying it should just become a matter of common sense and common courtesy and politeness to wear the mask. And I was thinking, no, because once you get that in that way to society, you will never get it out again. And I said, at least with a law, people will understand that it's something that's supposed to be temporary. So it is now a challenge, though, either way, with whichever way you do it. Once you get it in, how are you going to get it out? And I don't know. And it's one of the reasons I regret some of the measures and the ways that they've been imposed. I hope, is all I'm going to say, I hope that at some point all of it will be gone. Everything will be back to normal. COVID is something that is treated like the flu bug in the sense that there may well be annual vaccinations. Well, okay. I mean, that's not logistically difficult at the end of the day, or not much more difficult. You have the people on the priority list, as I'm on myself, actually. You get the text, you go down, you get your flu jab. Well, now you get two jabs at the same time. It doesn't have to be complicated. And I think that's what we ought to be looking to move back towards.
What about making a vaccination compulsory then, or, you know, having it as a requirement if you work in a care home or the NHS? It's a complicated question, isn't it?
It's a complicated question. Personally, I would not like to see it being made mandatory for absolutely everyone, because you need to retain that element of freedom somehow. I do think there's a case for saying if you work in a healthcare setting, though, and there are some other settings as well, where there needs to be a question of considering the level of responsibility people are going to be willing to take. And then you sort of think to yourself, well, actually, if you're not willing to make sure whether it's your MMR, remember that one?
Yeah.
ECG, it was back in my day as well. You know, all of those things. Well, you would expect people to have those if they worked in a healthcare setting. And we're going to have that sort of debate within the healthcare sector as to what we think is appropriate. But I expect there's going to be a leaning towards that expectation.
Yeah. I mean, it's going to be weird, isn't it? A world without kind of these restrictions, not having, you know, it seems normal now wearing a mask on a bus, doesn't it? Which in a way is a good thing, but in another way, it's pretty scary, isn't it? Because it happened pretty quickly. And I guess I get a bit worried when people don't start to question restrictions that might not be needed in the future.
Yeah. Like I say, this is the thing. The real danger is people getting used to it. The real danger is it becoming the new normal. And of course, the new normal is a phrase that's been used many times. And from my personal perspective, I don't want a new normal. I'd rather like the old normal back. With that said, you know, it's not as though there's nothing we can take away from a pandemic like this. I think there are people who have come to take more seriously certain aspects of, like, the washing of hands, that sort of thing. And maybe if we are all doing that a bit more, then, you know, the overall health of the nation will be better. But what you don't want is people doing that, or only doing that because they're scared. People doing things because they're scared, that doesn't go in a good direction.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So the question now has to be, how do we unscare people? That's the challenge the government now faces. It was incredibly effective, far more effective than it thought, I think, it was going to be, at terrifying people. So now how is it going to unterrify them? And that's the question.
And you're right. I mean, it was effective. And I think the Prime Minister Boris Johnson was quite surprised it was that effective, wasn't he? I think he probably didn't think that, you know, we would do as we were told to that extent. So, I mean, I was pretty astonished as well. Working in the media, working on TV, it was quite successful. And maybe that saved a lot of lives. But as you say, we do need to kind of move away from these restrictions. And, you know, I mean, it's coming from Brighton, it's nice seeing people on the seafront enjoying themselves. That is nice to see, isn't it? We want to be around people. We want to talk to people and interact with each other in person, not just always online.
Well, somebody I know made a comment, this is last year, to be fair, but back when we were all very much in the middle of lockdowns, and he was saying that he was sort of watching films, old films, not necessarily that old films, but and just looking at these scenes, and but they're not socially distancing. They're not wearing, this is how it gets into your head. You know, that's how it can be a worry. And for some people that will have happened, for others they will have ignored it completely, and we know there are those as well. So that's what we need to look at now. We need to look at how, as I say, we can unscare people. Now, it's worth remarking at this point, the data has been very, very good for months.
Yeah. You know,
since the success of the vaccination program, which of course is still proceeding. And so some people, the more libertarian persuasion, have been saying, well, why didn't we open up earlier? Why don't we just do it now? I mean, people aren't dying anymore. It's fine. I look at that and I think, well, I think I know what the reason is why they've continued to follow the roadmap regardless. Is A, because it's politics and they said they were going to do it. But B, because there are a lot of people out there who are still very scared, and you have to give people time
to adjust.
To adjust to getting back to normal. I think that's the rationale here.
The government are trying to fix. So speak to you then. All the best. Take care and speak to you soon.